It was one of the greatest triumphs in the history of British warfare. On the 25th of October, 1415, a sick, depleted and exhausted English army of 6,000 men defeated a French army five times its size. This is the Battle of Agincourt. At the start of the 15th century, France was the strongest power in Europe. But in just 15 years, she had been divided by civil war and was now ruled by an insane king. King Henry V of England, crowned in 1413, resurrected the ancient English claim to the French crown and, after 2 years planning, invaded France with an army of 2,500 mounted knights and 8,000 archers. The fortress town of Harfleur was the first to fall to the English, but disease soon took its toll on Henry's army and he was forced to march a severely depleted force of 900 knights and 5,000 archers north to English-held Calais. A journey that should have taken a week took twice that because Henry was forced to march until he found an unguarded point at which to cross the River Somme. Having marched 430 kilometres in 16 days, Henry came face to face with a huge French army near the village of Agincourt. The French force of 30,000 men was divided into three divisions, one behind the other on a kilometre-wide front between two woods. While this force was formidable, it was divided by internal conflicts and had no proper leadership. The English army was divided into three small divisions, side by side, with King Henry in the centre. The archers were distributed on both wings behind 1.8 metre sharpened wooden stakes. At about 11 o'clock, with neither side moving, Henry decided to act. He gave orders to advance slowly with the defensive stakes until his men were about 270 metres from the enemy. By this time, many French knights had wandered off from the wings and so missed their opportunity to attack the English as they advanced. The English archers fired a storm of arrows at the French to provoke them. It worked. The French knights, now only about 500 in total, set off over the cloying, muddy ground. Things went wrong from that moment. As the knights attempted to charge the English archers, thousands more armor-piercing arrows rained down on them. The archers then moved behind their hedgehog of stakes, and as the knights attacked, their horses hit the stakes and threw them off. As they floundered in the mud, the archers stabbed them through their visors or hit them with lead mallets. Chaos reigned as the retreating knights and many riderless horses, chased by another arrow storm, crashed into the advancing French foot soldiers. Those French who survived the arrow storm and managed to wade through the knee-deep mud attacked Henry and his foot soldiers in the centre. The English gave ground at first, but then started to push the French back. The English archers now entered into the hand-to-hand killing spree. Most, barefoot and comparatively nimble, were able to keep their footing in the mud and attack the sides of the French formation with their swords, knives and axes. Once again, the retreating French caused chaos as they fell back into the advancing 2nd Division. With many of their leaders dead or taken prisoner and seeing the horror before them, many of the 3rd French Division simply ran from the field. The battle was apparently over, but then Henry received news that the English were under attack from behind and that elements of the French 3rd Division were regrouping. With these new threats, the French prisoners could no longer be guarded, so Henry ordered that they be killed. Henry's knights, however, felt that this was unchristian and dishonourable and were conscious that prisoners would fetch a high ransom. It was left to the archers, and they began killing all but the richest and most prominent French captives. When the brief attack to the rear was over and the threat from the French 3rd Division didn't materialise, the seemingly impossible had happened. The tiny English army had destroyed a massive French force. The French lack of one firm leader and their choice of narrow, muddy ground had proved fatal. The English had sustained just 300 casualties and had killed or wounded approximately 7,000 French soldiers. The victorious Henry V was never to wear the French crown. It took a marriage and 5 years of political wrangling before he was eventually named heir to the French throne. But Henry died 7 weeks before the French king and never held the dual monarchy. He will be remembered for the mighty victory he won at Agincourt.